Selamat sore. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. We like to continue the panel discussion for breakout session 2.3. Yeah. So here, there are three panelists within this discussion. The first will be represent Pertamina, represent Director Pertamina Patraniaga. So and Pak Remigius Curnadi Kurniadi Tomo. The topic that will be presented with related to energy efficiency and clean energy development. Pak Remigius Kurniadi Tomo is a manager product and service development, commercial and trading, Perangkat Holding. So he well known in the sector of energy efficiency in Pertamina, especially in the Pertamina Patraniaga. He wrote some books there, 3 to 4 books. The first book related to menelusuri teknologi BBM perkapalan dan aplikasinya. So it's already been sold in the market. It's been published in 2017. The second book related to the biofuel dengan with the title Melawan Ketidakpastian Energi. This also been sold in the market. And then the book number 3 published in the year 2019, Renewable Energy, published by Pertamina. And then the book now published on the year 2019, The End of Oil and Gas Era. This this book and papers are winner on the Yes Gianstor Center event. So, Pak Remigius Kurniadi Tomo will present energy efficiency and clean energy development. That is the topic, the first topic for today discussion. The second represent Chairman of Hotel and Restaurant Association (PRI). Bapak Alexander Naiwan with the topic digital technology and energy efficiency in hospital industry, hospitality industry. So Pak Alexander Naiwan, he has some key position currently as a Vice President Operation PSM Hotels. Yeah. Advisory position for hotel operation in of the Panorama Hospitality Management, and he also advisor for Jakarta Hotel Association, and he also advisor at Nawacita Pariwisata Indonesia. He also advisor in Indonesia Hotel General Manager Association, and the last he also head of PRI Learning Center. PRI Learning Center, Perhimpunan Hotel Restoran Indonesia. So he like to bring the topic related to the digital technology and energy efficiency in his hospitality industry. So that is the second panelist. The last panelist will be represent CEO Max Power Indonesia. It is Bapak Fazil Erwin Alfitri. The topic will be developing clean power for low carbon development. Pak Fazril Erwin Alfitri is President Director of PT Max Power Indonesia. He is concurrently the President Director of PT Infradaya Energia since 2018. He is also the CEO of Max Power PTA Limited. He has extensive work experience in Indonesia and abroad, including General Electric USA, Malaysia, Singapore, and Brunei. The founder of PT Medco Power Indonesia and PT Infradaya Energia. He is expert of power generation business development, project finance, as well as oil and gas project development, black belt for Six Sigma quality management experience. He earned Master of Science in Mechanical Engineering from University of Pennsylvania, USA, Bachelor of Science in Mechanical Engineering from Wichita State University, USA. So we have three panelists here today, and each panelist will like to bring his presentation for about 15 minutes for each panelist. So start from Pak Kurniadi Tomo. And after Pak Purniadi Tomo bring his session, there will be discussion Q&A about 15 minutes. So each of the participant will have time about 15 minutes to have a discussion after his presentation. So to speed up the process, I like to give time to Pak Purniadi Tomo to bring his session. Pak Tomo, please. Take your time.
Thank you, Pak Hani. Thank you very much for let us participate and to let us share our Pertamina view in this energy efficient and clean energy development. You all can see in the slide that my presentation title will be Energy Efficiency and Clean Energy Development at Pertamina. Ladies and gentlemen, the first topic concerns the perspective of energy both at the world and Indonesian levels. Next slide, Pak Raka. Next slide. Yeah, the first topic will be global and Indonesia energy perspective. Please, next slide. Thank you, Pak Raka. Ladies and gentlemen, from this graph, we can see that it is unfortunate that petroleum and its product will still be used for a long time, even up to 2050. And currently, until 2030s, the demand is increasing. However, started from 2030s, growth has slowed down, unlike in previous years. Of course, thanks to internal combustion car engines that becoming more fuel efficient, and especially with increasing electrification of cars and motorcycles. The phenomenon of the continued popularity of petroleum, next slide, Liraka, is also seen in Asia, and next slide, and as well as in Indonesia. What is interesting here is that the demand for nafta continues to increase. The demand for nafta is increasing because the demand for petrochemical products continues to increase rapidly. Next slide, please, Pak Raka. And then the second topic will be talking about Indonesia fuel and fuel specifications in Indonesia. Except we can see in this table, the world's concern at the moment is the high role of primary energy of coal, which is considered the most polluting. Previous slide, Pak Raka, please. And again, previous slide. Yeah, I have to consider this slide because we can see that we are all concerning at the moment with the high role of primary energy of coal, which is considered the most polluting. But we are grateful because the government has announced a reduction in the use of coal by up to 90% by 2050. With the high role of fossil energy, not only coal, but also oil and then fossil fuel gas, it is not surprising that the US IEA, or International Energy Agency, has been warning that the new oil and gas exploration projects should be stopped immediately. And the IEA also assesses that between the rhetoric of the government and the industrial leader and the facts on the ground, there is very large gap. Next slide. Pak Raka, yeah, next slide please. Considering the portions of fuel oil in the energy mix is still very huge, the role of fuel in the context of clean energy is also very significant. Clean fuel is very influential in contributing to clean energy. One of the determining factors on the engine to produce clean exhaust gas is ensuring the installation of a three-way catalyst in the exhaust gas system. And this three-way catalyst can only work effectively if the fuel contains a small amount of sulfur and the lubricant contains a small amount of sulfated S, sulfur, and phosphorus. However, we do admit that regular gasoline in Indonesia is not yet suitable for the clean engine. You can see that the sulfur content of regular gasoline still contains highly reactive sulfur, which is a maximum of 500 ppm in the yellow color, Bapak Ibu. And fortunately, for high quality gasoline, which Pertamina call it premium, with the Pertamax Turbo brand, the sulfur content already supports the emission target for clean cars. You can see in the bottom table, we call it premium, and the Pertamina gasoline low sulfur fuel brand is Pertamax Turbo. We can see that the sulfur content of gasoline Pertamax Turbo is very low. Unfortunately, many Indonesians, even the rich users of expensive and new cars, don't care much, so that the market share of Pertamax Turbo is only 1%. Next slide, please, Pak Raka. By the way, how significant a new car can be reducing exhaust emissions can be seen in this slide. If our car and fuel switch from Euro 2 to Euro 3, then we can reduce emissions by 15%. Even it will be more fantastic if we switch to a Euro 4 engine and Euro 4 fuel, which is Pertamax Turbo, exhaust gas emissions can be reduced by almost 60%. Or in this right top table, it is written 59%. So the role of gasoline here is very significant. Similarly, in terms of energy efficient aspects. Next slide, please, Pak Raka. Everyone knows that an engine with a higher compression ratio means an increase in engine efficiency, which in turn reduces fuel consumption. And every engine expert say that engines with higher compression ratio clearly require gasoline with a higher octane number. It is not surprising that Lemtek, an University of Indonesia Research Institute, found that the use of 91 octane number per pallet, next slide please, Pak Raka, compared to the use of 88 octane number premium, could save about 5% fuel. You can see it in the part of slide in the bottom left, minus 5.42% of fuel saving. Next slide, please, Pak Raka. And then what about diesel? Diesel fuel or gasoil? Its role is equally huge. We also know that the determining factor for a diesel engine to produce cleaner exhaust gases is the installations of a diesel particulate filter. And then the EGR or exhaust gas recirculation design in the engine. Again, the diesel particulate filter and EGR or exhaust gas recirculations will only work effectively if the sulfur content in the diesel fuel and the undesulfated as sulfur and phosphorus content in the lubricant is really low. Unfortunately, the sulfur content in our regular diesel fuel is still high. You can see in the top of the table, regular diesel fuel, PPM, is still high. So it is not yet compatible with the clean diesel engine. What we pay attention to, this regular fuel user is very large. This is understandable because this fuel is still subsidized by the government. Although we are lucky that starting April next year, all new diesel engine, both passenger and commercial vehicles, must use diesel fuel with a maximum sulfur content of 50 ppm. Pertamina has long prepared a superior product, namely Pertamina DEX. You can see in the table of the bottom slide, premium diesel and then sulfur. You can see in the brand name of premium diesel fuel of Pertamina, Pertamina DEX over there. But the same case, I think, with Pertamax Turbo most likely will happen too to Pertamina DEX. We are also not too optimistic that next year, even the clean engine operators will be consistent to use compatible fuel. Although Pertamina, of course, will provide it throughout Indonesia, even if the product is not highly demanded by the customer. Again, the subsidies will be the main cost, Bapak Ibu sekalian. So, a clear, stable policy, support, and regulation from government, operator or user, and mostly original engine manufacturer are needed to realize the full potential of clean fuels, both Euro 4 gasoline and diesel engine for decarbonization options. Next slide, please, Pak Raka. A simple illustration of how our air has the potential to be blue, like the air and in developed countries, as in here. If you use a diesel engine like the current generations and use Euro 2 fuel, and you compare it with a Euro 4 diesel engine with Pertamina DEX Euro 4 fuel, the pollutant emissions will decrease by 64%, ladies and gentlemen. Next slide, Pak Raka, and then we go to marine sector. In the marine sector, Bapak Ibu sekalian, Pertamina has participated also in accordance with the recommendations of the International Maritime Organization, or IMO, the sulfur content in the residual fuel must be reduced from 3.5% to 0.5% starting in the year of 2020. Reducing sulfur is very important because sulfur oxides in the air can irritate the respiratory system, damage health, and cause lung disease. It can also cause acid rain, and acid rain can damage agricultural crops, forests, and aquatic life. So, one study in Finland said that if sulfur oxide was not reduced in ship exhaust gases, there would be an additional more than 500,000 premature deaths between 2020 to 2025. The important role of residual fuels was emphasized by IMO by equating the emissions of only a few ships with all cars worldwide. And they say that the largest marine diesel engines have more than 100,000 horsepower. In comparison, a mid-sized car may have up to 300 horsepower. Next slide, please, Pak Raka. And then we go to the third topic concerning the relationships between a biofuel plant, say biodiesel, and a traditional refinery that processing fuel like us in Pertamina. Next slide, please. Ladies and gentlemen, it turns out that at this time there is a important meeting point. In this slide, I say convergence between traditional refineries and renewable diesel fuel. At Pertamina, this renewable diesel fuel calls HVO, or hydrogenated vegetable oil. And also, there is another product, bioaftur, for airplane, on the aviation fuel. Ladies and gentlemen, there are many phenomena in the world where refineries that used to only process crude oil feedstock now using renewable feedstocks from plants and from animal fats. And the world's demand for these bioproducts is increasing rapidly, as shown in this graph, in this left side. Why increase? Because the price is relatively high. It is much higher than conventional products. The recent phenomena only started 10 years ago. Next slide, please, Pak Raka. Currently, the trend is towards waste raw materials, such as used cooking oil atau minyak jelantah, and then animal fat, or palm oil mill effluent, or POMI. HVO is much better than conventional biodiesel, and there is no limit on blending with fossil fuels like conventional biodiesel. In developed countries, mostly in Europe and in the US, the change to use HVO is very significant. Why did they get into this HVO business? There are many drivers, of course, but the biggest one is decarbonization. The mechanism is through tax instruments, which we will discuss later. Legislation began in the year of 2005 when the US banned the use of methyl tertiary butyl ether, or MTBE, as an oxygenate, thus increasing the popularity of ethanol. The most dramatic was in 2010 in Europe and 2013 in the US, with the enactment of renewable energy directives, fuel quality directives, and low carbon fuel standards, whose impact was immediately felt in Indonesia by hampering our CPO and biodiesel exports because the carbon intensity was still high in CPO and biodiesel. Therefore, Bapak Ibu sekalian, to reduce the current account deficits, the obligations, the mandatory to use biodiesel blend domestically is increasing, especially in Indonesia, the highest one in the world. Next slide, please, Pak Raka. In this slide, we will view the tax instruments I quote from Neste, the Finland SPO producers. Bapak Ibu, regarding these tax instruments, developed countries apply high CO2 taxes for high carbon intensity fuels and low or even zero CO2 taxes for low carbon intensity biofuels, such as HVO and fatty acid methyl ester or FAME or biodiesel, commonly widely found in Indonesia, but whose feedstock have to be waste, cannot be CPO. Although it has not yet been implemented, we are grateful that the Finance Minister of Indonesia has given a signal that the government will implement a kind of CO2 tax also, or in government terms, the carbon price or carbon pricings. The funds collected will be used to finance sustainable national development. This is very, very good. An illustration of the importance of carbon intensity is shown below. According to research, biodiesel blend B20 in Indonesia, let alone B30, Bapak Ibu, when used in diesel engine, will release emissions equivalent to CO2 between 2.6 until 4.1 per liter. Until 4.1 per liter. Ya, Pak.
Sorry, Pak. Your time is up for the presentation. Can you speed up your slide, Pak Kurniadi?
Ya udah, itu saja, Pak.
Oke.
Okay. That's all our view in energy efficiency and clean energy development at Pertamina. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Pak Kurniadi. It is interesting presentation, Pak Kurniadi. You focus on the development of new development of fuel, development of clean fuel for the transportation sector. So Pertamina trying to contribute on the efficiency in this sector by this developing this cleaner fuel that contribute for less emission and also increasing the combustion in the engine. So there are some fuel that you propose there, including gasoline fuel, diesel fuel, as well as the biofuel there. So I see there are still waiting for the quick question and answer from the participant. But then I have three questions, Pak Kurniadi, about this biofuel implementation from blending of this fatty acid methyl ester and also other type of biofuel such as ethanol mixture and also extract vegetable oil. What will be the contribution on the efficiency to the engine if the user use this biofuel? For example, to use a mandatory biofuel for the transportation sector, what will be the efficiency contribution of this fuel? And the second question related to the use of biofuel that that has been developed by using feedstock oil from palm oil. Yeah, palm oil. You know that palm oil is a food oil, it's edible oil. So to use this as a fuel for transportation, it must compete with the need for the food oil. The last question about the plan for implementing carbon emission rate or carbon pricing as source financing for sustainable development. My understanding, even biodiesel, selling of the biodiesel still needs subsidy, actually from the government. So the production of biodiesel, mixture, the cost to develop the biodiesel is still more expensive than the than diesel fuel. So if then in the future implementing this carbon emission rate or carbon pricing as source of financing, how it's possible this can be implemented massively in the transportation sector? So that is the three question, Pak. Probably you can have discussion about it.
Thank you, Pak Hani, for the first questions. We can say that the use of biofuel is mainly for clean energy. The address or the main purpose of the use of biofuel mostly for clean energy. It is not related at all with the fuel efficiency. Why? Because you know that the chemical compound of biofuels contains oxygen atom, and this oxygen atom have no energy heating value. So by adding some biofuel in the conventional diesel fuel, actually it will be reducing the energy content of the fuel. So it will be reducing also the fuel efficiency of the engine. So the main purpose of biofuel is mostly for clean energy. That's the first reason. And then the second reasons, we can see in the case of MTBE, which is changed by ethanol. The purpose of ethanol in the gasoline ethanol blend is mostly to increase the oxygenate in the fuel. Oxygens in the fuel, especially for gasoline engine, is very important because it can improve the combustion characteristics of the fuel. Once we have the most good and complete combustion, we will get lower emissions, and then we can have a fuel efficiency, better fuel efficiency. And then for the feedstock, especially for crude palm oil in Indonesia, which is being used as a source of biodiesel fuel. Actually, at the moment, I think there is no more about food versus fuel debate, because as you know, the productions of CPO in Indonesia is very significant, and not only the productions of CPO, but also the productions of biodiesel, of FAME, fatty acid methyl ester. There are many biodiesel plant already built in Indonesia, which is very ready to provide the biodiesel fuel in Indonesia. Even they are very ready to export this product to another country to reduce the current account deficits in Indonesia. And then you are very correct, Pak Hani. There is a kind of subsidy in biodiesel. We can see at the moment, actually the demand of biodiesel for Pertamina is higher than the allocations of biodiesel from Pertamina. I don't know why. Maybe it is caused by the subsidy that have to be put because of price difference between price difference or price disparity between biodiesel fuel and conventional diesel fuel. It is mainly the authorization of government. Pertamina, as a business unit, especially as a oil producer, Pertamina will implement the regulation on the mandatory from the government.
Thank you, Pak Kurniadi. So it was very interesting topic to discuss about this cleaner fuel technology implementation in the transportation sector. I believe Pertamina has a much contribution on it. I have so many questions actually to discuss, so many interesting questions to discuss. Probably that question probably will be valuable for our participant in this room. But due to of time, I think we can discuss in other time. Anyway, thank you very much, Pak Kurniadi, as your contribution on the discussion. So I'd like to move to the second speaker, Pak Alexander Nayoan. Pak Alexander Nayoan, you have 15 minutes to present your oral presentation. Please be brief, 15 minutes, so we have ample discussion for you. For long 15 minutes after your presentation. Take your time, Pak Alexander.
Okay. Good evening. Thank you very much for the time, Pak Hani, and a very good evening to all audiences. I won't have a presentation. However, I will be talking more about what we in the hotel and restaurant industry has done, especially during this challenging period of COVID-19, and what might have been support to reducing energy, and also what we did in terms of technology, digital technology. So, in the hotel industry, there are two factors which are very high cost. One is the manpower, and secondly is the electricity and power usage. You know, now within the electricity power, I would like to speak first about the usage of gas. Now, usage of gas is not that high. It's mainly for the kitchen, and most of the restaurants and hotels in Indonesia are using LPG. However, which is not very efficient for us, especially in terms of cost. So many has moved to LNG, or if the pipe is available, they use gas from PN Gas. Now, what will be beneficial for us in the hotel industry if the PN Gas could actually extend their pipelines to various places within Indonesia, big cities, and near to restaurants and hotel. Because this will really help the management of and the costing of most hotels. Secondly, is we are talking about electricity. Now, electricity, the most cost goes to air conditioning, and if the hotel has elevators, it will go to elevator. For the lighting is not that much, especially that nowadays you have a very efficient lighting system. But for AC, air conditioning, it can be very, very high. Hence, because of that, the old system where people are using central air conditioning is slowly but sure being left, you know. And most hotels are now being designed with individual air conditioning, which is considered more energy saving, yeah, And this can be controlled individually and by automation as well. Now, with the situation of COVID, usage of elevator is also reduced tremendously. Why? Because occupancy of hotels has decreased also tremendously, you know, not only in resorts, but also hotels in the cities. So a lot of hotels are now timing their elevator so that they can reduce the amount of electricity being used. The other thing is many hotels are using solar energy for their hot water generation. More and more hotels are installing this solar energy for hot water. But what will be very nice actually if the government can actually provide support or give special incentives for hotels which are actually using solar energy, not only for heating water, but also in using electricity for their day-to-day usage. As you know, in the United States and America and Australia, this incentive are being implemented. And if this can be done, it will be really very good so that the government can actually do a government regulation for being mandatory that hotels should use energy from solar panels within their own properties. And this can really help the sustainability of the hotel and also usage of electricity. Now, I'll be talking about now about the building itself. You know, many new ideas has been placed within the creation of building materials, which can actually absorb heat from outside, knowing that Indonesia is a tropical country, so that the usage of air conditioning can be reduced. Not forgetting to mention the usage of glass coating, you know, that again reduce the solar intensity toward buildings, so that that can again reduce air conditioning, which is one of the highest energy cost of most of the hotels, especially that clients, hotel guests, doesn't actually care whether they are using too much electricity or not, but for them is the comfort in their room, you know, having sufficient lighting, cold rooms is important. So these materials are very important, and also people are going more into the design, the architectural aspect of hotels, where they put more canopies, they put more plants surrounding the hotel, or even nowadays it's very popular to have plants growing on the building itself. Now this has been proven that it actually reduce the amount of heat generated into the building, which can actually reduce again the fuel. Now, some hotels are actually generating energy through biofuel, but this is only in properties, in resorts, which are related to being a sustainable, eco-friendly hotel. Not too many are able to do this because the lack of land, especially in higher, in big cities, it is not really possible. But what has been done in the last few years is to help reducing the usage of energy is menus in restaurants. If you may notice, in five-star hotel, four-star hotel, is getting lesser and lesser. Now, this actually again helped in the preparation, in the cooking method of the menu, again reducing energy being used. On top of that, the equipment being used are more user-friendly, electricity-friendly, where they use the same amount of electricity with less, where you can actually do much more in one go, you know. So in the hotel industry, it is known as the combi oven. You can actually cook rice at the same time you can cook your meat, your vegetable, by using the same amount of electricity or gas, you know. What is also getting bigger and bigger in the kitchen industry is what you call satellite kitchen, so main and satellite kitchen. There are many hotels which are closing their kitchens, their, but still have their restaurant open. However, their food are actually cooked in one place and then distributed to many hotels or many other restaurants, so that again, this will reduce the number of energy used in the restaurant, though it has to be transported by car or trucks and delivery. The latest invention that are already being placed in certain hotels, buildings, apartments, and factories are nanotechnology gasoline and electricity saving system, you know, where this is a Japanese, actually it's a German technology being developed more intensely in Japan, which is sort of a very thin layer of plastic, which consists of 18 layers. And you just have to put this nanotechnology on the gasoline tank or generator tank. And this can actually reduce around 8 to 15% of energy for gasoline or diesel oil. And for electricity, this nanotechnology is wrapped around cables and can reduce between 15 to 25% of energy. So if the government can actually optimize this new technology in many places, you know, which is already actually at the moment, I understand in Indonesia, certain government companies and factories are already using it. More and more electricity can be reduced. Yeah. The other thing is there are more cloud kitchens, yeah, which is again sort of a satellite kitchen where the restaurant is actually not there. Everything is through delivery, The kitchen is one, but one kitchen is actually providing the food for many brands at a time. Because nowadays, food delivery has become more and more intense. This actually reduced the number of people going to restaurants by car. So car fuel is being saved or reduced, but usage of although the usage of motorbikes in Indonesia is increasing for this delivery, but for sure it will be less than car usage for families to go to restaurants. So if there is less restaurant being used, means also electricity for the lighting and many other things are being reduced. So is this a very good thing that we have achieved? It's a yes. It's a yes and a no, because restaurants are closing down. However, small businessmen and women, which are producing food from their home and then delivered through delivery men like Gojek, GoFood, and all those Grab food and things like that are increasing. So it could be a very good news. The other thing that that is happening is robotic technology in many places. This again will reduce the number of people working in the hotels to a certain extent. However, increasing the number of people who are developing these robotic science and technologies, you know, and this can also help for sure reducing the number of people working in a hotel, which cause for sure a reduce of number of electricity being used. There is a new wave as well, where 4-star and 5-star hotels are actually closing down their in-house laundry. Why? Because for them, it's not efficient anymore, and it's very costly. So what is happening? Laundry companies are actually increasing. And this, again, is reducing the cost of individual laundries in each and every hotel into big laundries throughout the country. This also happened in the bread industry. It started in Europe and the United States and Australia, where hotels are actually closing down their bakery section. Why? Because first, it's expensive to pay for the baker, you know, his salary, but also to reduce electricity and everything related to bakery and also pastry. And this is now being put together into big bakery companies and pastry companies. If you may see all those cafes, well-known cafes throughout Indonesia and the United States, they only make the coffee, but all the food and snacks and bread and pastries are actually coming from individual companies, you know. The number, the other thing which is also happening more and more in restaurants is more and more buffet. Buffet is actually very much more cost saving than ordering a la carte. And on top of that, the amount of spoilage or items which are being thrown away is also being less. Yeah. So I can also talk about digitalization in the hotel industry, which are more and more people are using online travel agent nowadays. You know, where previously people are shopping by calling each and every hotel, but nowadays by OTA, yeah, and the usage of QR code, which are being used massively in all the hotels industry, especially after this COVID-19, where it simplify people in ordering and also payment. On top of that, people can also check in from their handphone, you know. So the number of receptionists can be reduced, and many hotels has created or has become a marketplace where they actually sell their branded item, and also a marketplace for workers, you know, whether they need new workers, new trainees, new everything related to manpower through digitalization. Okay, so I think that will be from my side. I completed my 15 minutes, Pak Hani. Thank you very much for the audience for listening, and wishing you a great evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Pa Alexander. There are so much information in your discussion for energy efficiency opportunity in the sector, the restaurant and also the hotel sector. So while waiting the question from the participant, I would like to discuss about the challenge of the investment of energy efficiency in the hospitality sector. You know that AC, air conditioning, accounts around 40% to 60% of energy costs in the hospitality sector, and then currently during the pandemic, they have a problem with this occupation, and also they also need to maintain the business there. And I believe due to of this pandemic, they still need to survive in the business, and then the only way for them to survive the business is trying to implement the energy efficiency project in their system. For example, by increasing the efficiency of their AC system. So you mentioned that they replacing the central AC system to individual AC system. How many percent that can be saved if the central system replaced with this individual AC system? I believe individual AC system can adapt the need for the hotel, because occupation of the hotel, when it reduced, so they reduce the consumption, the AC also can, the energy consumption in AC can be also reduced. So the implementation is individual AC, probably the best approach to save the energy there. But can you provide us information how many percent that can be saved actually? And if there other hotels like to replicate the same success, how is possible the investment in this sector? Is it possible as co-involved on the sector, or is this also possible to implement a different technology, for example, heat pump technology for the coolings, not only to use a compression vapor cycle system on the AC system, but also heat pump. This is new technology that not new actually, it's already been there for a long time, but not so many people know, not only for AC, but also for heating. The last question is about the regulation related to rooftop solar PV. You know that there is a regulation from MEMR related to the implementation of rooftop solar PV. This is MEMR regulation number 49 that allow building who actually the customer from PLN to install rooftop solar PV. Those regulation number 59 year 2020 is now under revision, right? So I'm unfortunately involved on the revision process. There are some incentive within the this regulation. The first incentive is to provide net metering. Actually, you can sell your electricity when you connect to the grid, your rooftop solar PV. You can sell electricity that you produce to the grid with the 65% cost. And you can also keep your electricity in the grid, we call it just as banking period, for about 3 months. So example, you have excess of electricity produced from rooftop solar PV. It can be saved in the grid of PLN, but the banking period only for 3 months. So the new revision of regulation of this rooftop solar PV will increase the net metering, no longer 65% to sell the electricity, but 100%. So you buy 1 kilowatt hour price, and then you can also sell 1 kilowatt hour price with the same price there. And also increasing the banking period, not only 3 months, but it can be more than 3 months. So there are some incentive actually within this rooftop solar PV implementation. So what will be your comment and also discussion about that, Pak Alexander?
Yeah, thank you, Pak Hani. Yeah. With regard to your first question on how many percent hotels can actually reduce by using the individual AC, yeah. First of all, hotels who has already a central AC system, it's quite difficult for them to shift. However, as you mentioned, by heat pump is one of the solution, you know. This can reduce between 10 to 18%. This is what I understand. However, what I mentioned is actually the new buildings that are being used, they are more and more are no longer using the central AC system, but the individual system. Now, asking how much percentage these hotels can save. During the COVID-19, the saving is 100% because they just closed their hotel and that's it, you know. Sorry to say, yeah. But it can go as high as 100%. But an up and running hotel with occupancy of 10, 20, 30%, you know, which is happening right now, the saving could actually be almost like 60% of what they are supposed, what they used to spend, you know. So I hope this this reply to your question, you know. With regard to solar energy, most of us in the hotel industry are very much aware of this regulation. However, what is quite difficult for us is implementing it because the solar cells are at the moment still very expensive and not subsidized yet. Or the taxation is still very high. So it is not really beneficial for hotels actually to go into this system and regulation. So if the government can actually see how they can reduce the cost of these solar panel and have an easier system in funding it, it will really be beneficial for us. I think that's from me, Pak Hani. Thank you, Pak.
Okay, we don't have much time left, yes. But only one question, Pak Alexander, from me. To anticipate the sector for going back to business to new normal condition, it is good actually for the sector to prepare themselves. Yeah, it is good time for them to prepare themselves to be much more efficient in the design the system and preparing the system for mechanical, electrical, and also others, so that in the future when it come back the business in the new normal condition, they can operate the system much more efficiently in terms of the cost there. So what will be the most important in the sector to prepare all of those things?
Yeah, so actually COVID-19 is a blessing in disguise, Pak. Yeah, blessing in a sense, everyone suddenly have to think on how to reduce their cost. Yeah, and each and every hotel will find their own way in reducing it. Not only energy, but also manpower. Yeah. So if you ask me what is the main thing that they have to focus is actually electricity, you know. But there is a more important aspect which not only the hotel should go in, but also the government is to train people, to make people understand that energy is very important and how we can actually save that. And more socialization from the government should be done throughout the country, you know, on how to respect energy and how to reduce energy. That is more important than only the hotel trying to find ways and means of reducing electricity. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Pa Alexander. It is very insightful. Thank you very much also for your presentation. To consider the time, now I'd like to invite the third panelist, Pa Fazil Erwin Alfitri, to present his presentation on the developing clean power for low carbon development. Pak Fazil, you have 15 minutes, Pak Fazil, to consider time. Please take your time for this 15 minutes. Be brief, Pak, so we will have time to the rest of the time to discuss your PowerPoint presentation, if you have that. Please, Pak.
Okay, thank you very much, Pa Hani. Thank you very much, everyone. Good evening. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Peace be upon you. Okay, my topic of today's presentation, basically strategy for clean power generation for low carbon development. So maybe different than the previous speaker, I'm more on the supply side of the energy. And I like it to be more, you know, so I'd like to be able to supply more. But I understand that we have to supply more electricity with the most efficient way so that it becomes cost effective for everyone, not only us, but also our customers. Okay, so let me begin my presentation by going through the fact sheet about Indonesia. So, Mona, next. Okay, so I hope you can see this. Slides. This is basically a map of Indonesia showing you how is the electrification ratio among the five major islands of Indonesia. So as you can see, the electrification ratio is actually pretty good. It's reaching 100%, which I think the aim by the government is to reach 100% by the end of this year. Okay, but what does that mean? It doesn't mean anything, to be honest, because the 100% electrification ratio doesn't mean anything, because it just means that that island has, or that kampung, or that villages reach electricity. That's it, you know. But then it doesn't tell whether everyone has the same quality of electricity. It doesn't tell whether everyone has the same consumption of electricity. So then, with 285 million of Indonesian, basically in 2025, and it's going to grow to 335 million by 2050. Like what I said, efficient ratio is going to reach 100% by 2021. But as you can see on that table that I presented to you here, when you talk about per capita electricity consumption. excuse me, per capita electricity consumption, Indonesia relatively very very low, considering the big nations, the biggest country in ASEAN, but among ASEAN countries, we are relatively very very poor in terms of consumption per capita. So, not many of us or average of Indonesian basically consume less electricity per capita compared to the neighboring countries. So to put it into perspective, Indonesian probably only 1/6 of Malaysia or 1/10 of Singapore. Yeah, so that tells you how lacking the electricity is in Indonesia. Even though the country already reached 98% electrification ratio this year, you know, but it doesn't mean that everyone has the same quality of power everywhere. And you would be able to see it. I think if you go east, you know, the more eastern side of Indonesia, you will see that actually the situation persists. You know that you know the supply of electricity is not stable. It's not stable. So the quality of service is basically also not stable. Now, we are all talking about renewables. I think that's also our goals, to basically enhance or improve the renewable supply of electricity to the country. But I think I must be blunt and basically saying that we are coal country. We are coal and fossil fuel country, whereby it's not practical in archipelago situation like Indonesia to rely on all renewable. I think that may be doable if you are in Europe or you're in the United States, where you are linked into a big grid and have all kind of power generation there. But we are in the archipelago situation where the grid is not mature. Many of our islands, especially on the eastern side of Indonesia, is basically isolated system. It's not connected. It's not that well connected to the grid. So it's very, very, very isolated. This is basically distributed generation country. And so happened that Max Power is there. Max Power is basically distributed generation power company that basically focus on distributed generation. Okay, so just come back into the fact sheet again. We will need additional power plant capacity for additional 56 gigawatt between 2019-2028. That basically just to keep up with the demand, you know. A long time ago, when the demand is not fulfilled, and also the supply is not there, right? PLN is basically introducing demand side management. So which is basically just like this: energy efficiency, using what do you call it, low voltage light, you know, instead of your ordinary lamp, you know. So that is one way to basically reduce the demand. So demand side management, I think that's very important. Maybe about 5 to 10 years ago. Now by 2028, energy fuel mix, coal is going to be reduced, right? But still, it's going to be very high. It's going to be more than 50% of the supply of electricity in Indonesia still going to be running on coal. The aim is to have new and renewable energy basically around 23%, which is not there right now, and 22% basically gas, which is most of our gas today is basically exported to overseas, right? And I think more and more we see that actually domestic demand is picking up, and I think we have to use Indonesian gas for domestic demand to make it cleaner. But then you still cannot get away from diesel. I think diesel is still needed on remote areas, that area that doesn't have the fossil fuel supply, support. But also, this is maybe opportunity for what I think is renewable, right? Which I'd like to move it to the next slide. Next, please. Now, when you talk about renewables, renewable energy in Indonesia, there are many options. I like to talk. I like probably start by saying that we are on the ring of fire, right? So as a ring of fire, there's a lot of volcano. Then it meant that our geothermal potential is very big, probably the biggest in the world today, right? There's about 29 to 30 gigawatt geothermal potential in Indonesia. But if you see, we only install about 2.2 gigawatt, not even 10%. Not even 10% of the potential. I think the plan by 2028, basically from that 2.2 gigawatt to reach about 6 gigawatt, still very, very small compared to what the potential is. Now, why geothermal is probably what I like to start with. Okay. Not only that I'm also a strong believer in the geothermal potential in Indonesia, but geothermal power plant is easily dispatched. Means that you can decide, or you can basically instruct the power plant to run at, for example, 100 megawatt or 50 megawatt or 20 megawatt, something like that, you know. Whereas if you rely on solar PV, wind, and others, that's basically called by nature. It's decided by God whether you have radiation intensity at that moment, then you can have your 20 megawatt solar panel producing that much or not, right? So it's very, very unpredictable in terms of solar, wind, and other renewable, whereas on geothermal and hydro, maybe is dispatchable. So you can dispatch. PLN say, I need 50 megawatt. You can instruct your power plant, your geothermal power plant, okay, 50 megawatt, open the valve, 50 megawatt, here it comes, okay? So geothermal potential very big, hydro also very big, because we are in a, you know, basically, there's a lot of river, there's a lot of lakes and so on. There's about almost 100 gigawatt potential. Solar PV is even more, 208 gigawatt potential. But then if you look and realization, install capacity for solar PV is very, very lacking. Wind about 60 gigawatt, installed basically almost nothing, you know. So that is the reality of the thing. That is what happened in Indonesia. I guess then you would ask, why is that so, right? So give you an example. Maybe I'd like to dwell into solar PV, because that's going to be my next presentation, and I think this is fits well with to what we can offer in terms of developing low carbon development. So if you would go to the next slide, please. So I'm giving you example that what has been done in this country. This is actually nice work done by Eco Energy, Maskara, and Tina Mitra Mandiri, which they are actually developing solar PV, right, to produce clean water for this island in NTT. The name of the island is Papagarang Island, which is around Komodo Islands in the NTT province. Because in a typical island like this, small island that basically doesn't have river, people relying on the catching of the rain, I guess water catchment coming from the rain, they are relying on the rain basically to get their fresh water, or maybe they relying on the fresh water coming in from the neighboring islands, which they have to basically ferry for some cost, right? So this idea is actually to use solar PV, solar photovoltaic, basically to move the pumps, yeah, to move the pumps that can basically filter brackish water, or can be also seawater, right? You pump the water into membrane, which is a reverse osmosis, and as a result, basically you get drinking water. I mean, as simplified explanation of that. So from brackish water become drinking water. For that island that basically doesn't have infrastructure like this, which is quite a lot in eastern side of Indonesia, this is a very, very good project and really make an impact to the community there. So the community basically then can rely on solar PV to get their water, and also other energy in terms of lights, electricity, and stuff like that. So this is one example. So solar desalination, solar PV for water supply. Next, please. This is basically same thing. I just explained. Basically, this is a pilot project, yeah, because which I think is it should be developed. I guess you should ask many big company to create CSR project like this, so you can basically empower those islands that basically doesn't have other means to produce water and be able to get clean water that way. So solar PV basically can be used to generate electricity. It can produce water source for local people, water source for irrigation, and also farming. Why this is important? Because solar power project basically require big land. 1 megawatt of solar energy require 1 hectare. So let's go into the next slide, please. So 1 hectare equivalent roughly about 1 megawatt. So if you want to develop, give example, like 20 megawatt solar power project, you need 20 hectares of land. And that's not practical in the case of Indonesia, because some of our land are quite fertile. So it better used for farming rather than used to create energy, right? But study actually prove that by combining the solar PV with your farming, you can improve the result of both quite nicely, you know? So by having solar PV installed above basically crop, yeah, it helped the crop to produce more product, right? And also be able to get the energy that the area needed from the solar PV. So this is actually efficient, right? You're combining the productive land for your energy needs as well. Because you don't want to be in the situation that you are trying to create renewable energy, but then you're competing with food, or you're competing with the land that otherwise can be used for farming. I think we need to learn from what happened in Brazil, maybe, where they're trying to create methanol, but then that competing with food, you know. So this is maybe one aspect of it that we need to consider. I think we are trying to create something like this as well for our project that we have, maybe part of the CSR project to basically combine the agrovoltaic solar for farmland and also solar PV. This is basically the concept of combining solar energy with your farmland. Next. You can use also your solar power to increase your fishery production, right? I think this is done in Japan. This is done also in other part of the world. They prove that actually by having solar photovoltaic offshore or maybe in the lake or on the lakes, whatever it is, that can also improve your fishery production, because it basically provides shade. Provide shade, and also it's basically make the fish basically able to produce more eggs and then be able then to increase their quantity in that sense, right? So this is actually used for field cultivation. The energy also can be used for cold storage eventually to generate electricity and also water source, okay? Next. Okay. Now I'd like to go into our case study. This is actually a case study that's done by MaxPower. We are trying to basically we are studying Sumba, okay? Island Sumba. Sumba now basically become the Sumba iconic island, right? It's a very beautiful island. It's a tourist destination spot. You know, one of the most expensive tourist destination is actually here in Sumba. But the island itself is basically still running on diesel fuel, right? Because there are no gas pipeline, there's no other fossil fuel there other than diesel. But then if you want to develop your tourism industry, right, I think you have to really think hard about maybe better for you to develop a more sustainable way to create your energy. So we studied Sumba, and we concluded that Sumba from radiation intensity is actually very, very good. I mean, if you compare with the rest of Indonesia, this is one of the best radiation. And so happened also that the location that you need power the most, which is the location that have more population, have the best or has the better for radiation compared to the rest of the island. Okay, so this is things that we are considering basically to put solar PV. Maybe we better go to the next slide. So the idea is actually to put it around Tambolaka, you know, which is on the western side of Sumba. But then you understand that solar power is basically intermittent power. Means that if there is only maybe good for 4 to 6 hours a day. You know, it's maybe between 10 in the morning up to 2 in the afternoon or 3 in the afternoon, you know, depend on where you are. If you don't have cloud, then it's maybe going to be strong, but if you have cloud, then you can lose. So the power generated can be intermittent. Means that it's there or it's not there, you know. So maybe say like you want 3 megawatt, maybe at 1.3 megawatt, the next second it's become zero, right? I mean, that happened. If you have cloud covered, then basically there are no swap here. So as a result, you need basically a system that can handle this hybrid, that can handle this intermittent, whereby this is where we think that you need to have this hybrid solution. So it means that solar PV combined with gas engine, right? Why gas engine, not diesel engine? Because gas is cleaner, relatively cleaner compared to diesel engine. And the diesel engine, the gas engine, basically the one that is going to provide the power cover if you have intermittent supply from the sun. Okay, so this is the kind of thing that we are developing. It can also go into all those things that I mentioned in the beginning, you know, solar desalination, agrivoltaic, and so on. But then still, I think in the eastern side of Indonesia, you have to combine renewable with gas engine, diesel engine, or any other conventional power plant. Okay, next. Okay, so that basically the bulk compression. I'm just going to explain to you a bit about where we are. Max Power Group, basically now part of Medco Group, belong to the Medco family. So inside Medco, you have two power companies. One is Medco Power, and also the other one is basically Max Power. So how you differentiate Max Power more into distributed generation. So whereas Medco Power is more into your conventional power generation connected to the grid. Next. So, you know, Medco, just a very, very short explanation. Medco basically conglomerate of energy, mining, and infrastructure. And the company basically founded by Pak Arifin Panegoro and has been in Indonesian business landscape since 1980. Next. Now, why distributed generation? Why distributed generation is still important in Indonesia? Because, the distributed generation by definition is basically a method of generating electricity at or very near to the load demand or end user to meet the specific customer needs. So basically you are on directly producing power directly at the demand. Relatively small generation, so it's not a big power generation, and it can be interconnected with the main grid, but most likely we are basically isolated from the grid. So we basically providing power for the isolated system. Then if you look at Indonesia, why distributed generation is very important? Because Indonesia is basically archipelago. Not every island is well connected by PLN grid. So sometimes you need to have your basically create your own grid, or that island rely on their own grid, and that probably not there. And this distributed generation can provide solution for those people in needs. Okay, next. This is basically just to show where we are at. As you can see, we are basically all over Indonesia. from Aceh to Papua, you know, basically, with, you know, power generation size that basically relatively small compared to your typical conventional power plant. But this is what the country needs for the time being. While the grid is not mature, Indonesia grid is basically relatively immature. Maybe only Jawa grid that basically very, very developed, but other grid basically not that developed compared to the Java grid system. Okay, next. So we provide basically fast power, mobile power, basically then it can be, you know, bring to any location, affordable, of course. Otherwise, it will not be make sense, right? If you have a very expensive power plant, this is basically quick solution, most economical solution. What important also scalable means that it can be customized to what the demand is. So normally, when we develop a project, we develop in such a way that basically you can scale up the development as your demand increases. So we don't need to build too big of a power plant in the beginning, you know, and this can be done through the modular connection or modular system that we have. So next is basically the challenge. This is basically, okay, typical power plant that we have. This is a power plant that we have in Batam, Sorong. We also have power plant in Myanmar, in Myanmar, close to the Yangon city. We have also power plant in Lok Sumawe. This is basically inside the Kertas Kraft Aceh site. Next. So maybe I'll close my presentation by explaining or maybe by summarizing the challenge for cleaner power development with a low carbon footprint, right? Okay, when you talk about renewable, and when in this case, I'm talking about the solar PV development, in the renewable space, solar PV, wind, hydropower, and so on, it depends on nature. Okay, so it's not continuous. I don't think it's ever be continuous because it actually depends on whether you have you have the energy given by God at the time or not. So it's very, very intermittent, and therefore maybe this is also the case there where you need to have a smart grid in your system. Or PLN need to have a smart grid, so it can anticipate if there is that intermittency, and it can compensate by other conventional power plant out there. So, combination with mini LNG to power hybrid solution can be suitable to maintain 24-hour operation. I think that's the aim. Now, renewable. Okay, people think that, oh, maybe I get my power from the sun, so it should be cheaper. It's not, because the technology is costly. The technology for this renewable basically still expensive in a way, so that it needs to have a slightly higher tariff so that it can meet the return same as your conventional power, you know. So this is the challenge. That's why, as you can see in my previous slide, why it's not developed in a country like Indonesia that has so much potential, like why it's not developed? Simply because the country probably doesn't give enough incentive to make it develop. So this is a challenge for all of us to basically, you know, set our differences aside, you know, because PLN always want to buy cheap power. But then when you buy cheap power, then you rely on dirty coal power plant, and you left your renewable, which is still expensive now, aside. Which is, if you continue developing your renewable, I think, even though it's going to be very expensive in the beginning, but eventually the tariff is going to be competitive over the time. Because as you have more capacity, then you will be able to take advantage of the scale and mass of that renewable platform. Right? Land, I think land and infrastructure is a challenge, especially in fertile farming land, like in the west of Indonesia, like Jawa or Sumatra, that's expensive. As you can see, to purchase land in Jawa for solar PV project, is very, very expensive, almost impossible. Whereas maybe this is more suitable to the eastern side of Indonesia, where the land is less fertile and there's not much crop to be produced. Maybe that is where you want to concentrate your renewable in terms of solar PV in that area. Okay, so maybe I will pause there. Pak Hani, thank you very much for the opportunity. I welcome any question if you have, if anyone has. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pak Fazil. It was very interesting presentation, Pak Fazil. So it proposed the idea of distributed energy resource or distributed generation to bring Indonesia to energy transition from centralistic to become decentralistic. So there are many challenges actually. This is the problem for almost not only Indonesia but also other country. They are changing the utility sector from centralistic to become decentralistic electricity production. So it needs energy transition process or electricity transition process if we focus on the electricity sector. So currently, government proposed energy transition roadmap 2050. So Pak Director of PLN, ya Director, President Director of PLN, they proposed the ET 2050, that in the 2050 there will be net zero emission, yeah, net zero emission for electricity sector. But that is challenge there. The key three pillar in this transition is the implementation of energy transition roadmap plan and also the modernization of the grid there. And the last is the energy conservation or energy efficiency implementation. Without that three pillar, it will be very difficult Indonesia to move to energy transition 2050 for net zero transition. Now, I like to see there, and by the way, I already visit Papagayarang Island, Pak. I visit there probably around 5 years ago, whenever I was working with USAID project there, and then try to promote some, replicate the same implementation in Papagayarang Island to scale up the project there, to use our PV to energize the pumping system and also the desalination system. It is good, Pak. It is good. It needs to be replicated in other places. Though it's not only for desalination system, but also for fishery industry there. You know that Indonesia is a 60% of area of Indonesia occupied by sea. It means actually opportunity for fishery business. Fishery industry in Indonesia is massive. But then a lack of the concern from government, probably from the business, because of the lack of the energy supply in that side. For example, if you see in the island, in the eastern part Indonesia and out the western part Indonesia, fishery industry need a cooling storage there. And then it keep the fish fresh in all the time. Just they can bring that to the market. And also aquaculture business. The aquaculture business for freshwater fish industry need to be increased or replicated of this rooftops or PP of this energy, renewable energy project are necessary. But the challenge, you already mentioned the challenge, feasible investment of this system. We have not so much time left, Fazil, but I like to have one question. This is the most important question. You know that the key of the technology of distributed energy resource or the distributed generation is the renewable energy itself. That is the most key, or the hybrid of this renewable energy. So the storage, the MC2 is not from MC square, not from the Einstein formula, but monitoring, management, the control system. That is the key, the brain of the, you say that smart system. And then distribution system and also islanding operation whenever in the future distributed generator connected to the main grid. So the challenge there, actually, whenever Indonesia has 3 to 5 major grid in island, if they like to expand or transform the grid to become distributing grid, it means actually reduce the use of the transmission line. How that possible through the energy transition 2050, yeah, it can be implemented economically, financially, or feasibly, because the challenge now, PLN is one is a utility, single utility, and then they operate like one hierarchy utility. So it's very difficult for them to operate this distributed energy generator. It means actually the role of the private sector. So what will be your comment on that part?
To be honest, I never believe that PLN should be only the only one that providing transmission and distribution for all the people, because I think if you force PLN to do that, then they have to prioritize on what is the low hanging fruit for them, right? Whereas I think government has been trying in the past and maybe still not successful, basically giving private sector opportunity if they want to basically develop certain area like Wilus, maybe like that. Wilus, wilayah, you know, for acting as utility, right? Now, this is something that actually we as METCO would like to do. I'd like to do it. You know, maybe, for example, I give you an example, like, for example, if government allow us to develop Sumba, you know, from A to Z, not only from generation, but all the way to transmission, distribution. So you're creating GenCo, Transco, Disco, but then still collaborate with PLN in terms of collection, right? Because that's important, right? If you don't have the close collection mechanism, which is PLN has been doing that for all the people, for all the people in Indonesia, then it would not be bankable in a way. But we would be more than happy to take that opportunity if there is any opportunity like that given to us to maybe try to do something on smaller scale, not the PLN scale, but on smaller scale that may be important for us. Sumba is one. I would say for METCO may be important to develop Merauke because we have forestry business in Merauke. Maybe some other island like Central Sulawesi where we have LNG facilities in Senoro, maybe like that. So that area of Central Sulawesi, we probably more than happy to act as a solid system. Now, don't forget, distributed generation approach has been done in Europe all along. Company like Engie now move away from big power plant business. I think they are now basically realize that actually the big GenCo is thing of the past. Because as you have grid connectivity, everything is wired, connected, like what is happening in Europe now. It's not important to own large scale power plant. It's actually better be in the business of power plant services, right? Which what we are talking about here, you know. So this is also going to enable, like what you said in the beginning, for example, people that has solar panel in their house, their rooftops, and so on, be able to supply power to the grid, and then be able to basically also make some money out of it as they have more power access that they can sell to the grid. And grid needs it, then it will further expand the renewable penetration into the market. But in the case of Indonesia, it's very hard to do because we are archipelago, you know, so we don't have this interconnectivity from Sabang to Merauke. Everything done on the island base, you know, so some island, big island like Jawa is good, it's okay, you would be able to do it. But some island very small, like Sumba or even some other smaller island, that basically the only way to do it is basically just maybe ask a private sector like METCO, which has interest, to try to help out and try to develop there, you know.
Very good, Pak Basil. There are the disadvantage can be advantage in the future with the distributed generator generation concept, Pak. Because you can focus on the more productive economic zone, more productive economic area, where actually there are some economic activity there, but lack of electricity, and then that probably can be a good place to replicate a success in other places of process, but in Isumba that we already success there. There are many places, but I believe you will be success in the future because we are going to that direction. And an energy transition roadmap 2050 already been stated by the government, and then PLN like to start it. So very fortunate that I also involved on that work together with USAID. Anyway, thank you very much all the speaker, Pak Kurniadi, Pak Alexander, and also Pak Basil. We have productive discussion, though probably respond from the participant. There are no response from participant because we are in the wrong time, probably in the evening. So participant probably already involved in earlier, so they have enough information from us. To make it short, thank you very much again, and hope you stay in good health and success. Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Salam. Thank you.